Hi, this is investigative journalist Annie Dance with Cops in Congress. Please subscribe to anniedance.substack.com for my Cops in Congress newsletter, where I work to shine a light on police and policy issues in Lake Lure, Rutherford County, Western North Carolina, and beyond. Today, Wednesday, April 17th, 2024, the North Carolina General Assembly is hosting a committee meeting about elections. Let's see what they have to say with today at the NCGA.
The intended purpose of that money, it never occurs. The question was asked about working with GDAC or Social Security Office. And I also want to acknowledge, I know North Carolina was either the last or one of the last states to have electronic death records. So, you know, we had a lot of things holding us up to get there, but has there been any communication with HHS about maybe getting that dumped into GDAC, having access to that? Because those folks would be here in North Carolina. Seems it'd be faster than dealing with Social Security Administration. Could you comment on that?
We've already gotten commitment. Well, we already get the death records from DHHS, but for years we have been getting them on a monthly basis. You're right, making those electronic records and being able to put them into a database seamlessly has been a big improvement. It used to be the case that we would tell people there's like a 3-month lag between a death and whenever we were able to identify it for removal for the county board. I think that's really improved with the electronic death record system. With Senate Bill 747, we're going from a monthly report from DHHS to a weekly report. So we'll get those reports on a weekly basis every week of new deaths that get reported in North Carolina. So we're tapped into them directly, and we'll continue to do that. So we're going to be pushing that data down to the county boards for removing records much more frequently.
And I can't miss an opportunity to say go Pack.
Right.
We have bumped into each other at games, and we know our shared support for the Wolf Pack. But that is not why I came on the mic. But I will add to that. Paul's talked about the various specifics that we're doing. If you need more metrics, if you need more reports, we will provide those if that is the difference of how we get some of these positions funded. I think the way that we're going about, and if you would like to give me $160 million, I will take you up on that offer and do all the reports myself if I need to. But the $8 million we were talking about, the request to modernize our SEAM system and having about 2/3 of that funding, we would like to see that fully funded. But I will say, one of the criteria you put in place was to have us do quarterly project reports. And this is a 5-year project as we've mapped it out. So, we've already initiated those reports. I think that's a good system. I have my project management certification. This isn't a big leap for us. To the data requests, we have put in new data checks. We have also made more data more public, and you're spot on about the fact that that does raise more questions. We've worked hard to put out explanatory documents with the data so that people understand better what those terminologies mean, things of that nature. But we have not expanded that team to a ratio of the number of requests that we've gotten. Prior to 2020, we had more like 50 requests. We could manage it in a spreadsheet and through our email. That jumped so significantly that we did secure software called Next Request that just is a management system for public records requests. We knew some of the counties were using it, and we followed the county lead at that point in time. Thank goodness, because they are so substantial. The number of requests, the volume that's within the request, that it has taken that, and happy to provide some of those numbers. I know at this point, some of our conversations getting into funding of positions and how that might be helpful. We did not come with our metrics today, but happy to share that with y'all. We've talked it over with fiscal research and continue to track that so that we can provide you the evidence of why these are so critical. And, I will just point out that You know, when we are talking about our data, we talk about 7.4 million registered voters. That's just a drop in the bucket of the amount of data that we're managing. In North Carolina, we have list maintenance. We can change status of voters. You know, they could be active, inactive, removed. But just because they've been removed, meaning they don't appear on our poll books, we still maintain those records. So our database of voter registration alone far exceeds the number of active registered voters that we have. And, you know, and that doesn't even, you know, include all the other records that we maintain for candidate filing or campaign finance and so forth. So at present, we have one database administrator. That's a little bit scary. Thank goodness we have a very talented chief information officer who understands database and can serve as a backup, but we're really not effectively cross-training or doing the things that are, you know, intended to be, you know, in place to have
I know right now it's a pain and it's a lot more work, but getting to a place where it follows the average person's common sense ideas of what should happen. Like if you have X number of people vote, you know, all the math should add up. We shouldn't have orphan records out there or things that have the appearance of impropriety, even if they're not improper. I just think a simplistic interaction and a format and updated maintenance, I think it drives down the workloads in the future. You know, once it's easier to get to and people really understand more of it, I would hope that questions would go down as our maintenance improves over time. I wanted to refer to, and this is my just last question or comment. I think it was slide 23. It's about your turnover at the state board. And I think someone mentioned this earlier, but not to be argumentative, but I really don't know what this means, because to your point, we don't have it from earlier years, so I don't know what's normal. I'm sure that turnover's rarely been zero, so it's some number in there, right? And I don't know if that's 2, 3, 4, or 5, but if there is a delta, it's not from 0 to 10, which looks like a rough average. It's between whatever normal turnover is and that. So without it, we don't really know. And I do appreciate the loss of institutional knowledge. So I get that. But just in looking at this data, the number of changes looks really consistent between 19 to 24. And even if it's up by half, we're really talking about losing 5 per year. So it just doesn't feel like that monumental to me. But and it was your point, we don't have it from before, so I don't know what to compare it to or what's average. I do appreciate the loss of institutional knowledge, but this doesn't look, it looks pretty consistent to me. I just wanted to share that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Perry. I have a couple questions for you, Director. So you talked a little bit about the pilot for the signature verification and that, you know, that's been delayed, and the legislation that we passed says that you would send us a report on May 1. Can you give us a preview of what that report will say?
Well, right now, the report is likely to say, and that's part of why we made sure to bring that to your attention today, is that, you know, we are dealing with a procurement situation. If we can secure the vendor, even in the next couple of weeks, we will try to move forward with the actual scanning of the envelopes and further our analysis, but I don't believe we're going to be able to provide you with a complete analysis of the pilot by May 1. Simply, you know, even if we are able to, you know, go through the scanning process, if there are signatures that do not match, we will need to call county board meetings so that they can look at the ones that are thrown out and not thrown out, that sounds awful, not matched within the software. And so, you know, it's, we're doing everything we can, but there are certainly added variables that we did not anticipate in our due diligence.
And so to follow up on that, are you saying that you're hopeful that this could be used in the runoff?
It was the legislation was intended for the primary. So for us, it's going to be to take the ballots that were, you know, sent absentee by mail.
You're going to look back instead of forward. Okay, got that.
Well, I will point out, I mean, we should not use it during the second primary for the fact that that is not a criteria. So we are purposefully not having it be factored in. There were many citizens who expressed concerns about whether absentee ballots would be counted or not based upon signature verification. And we've had to make sure that they are clear that this is a pilot and has no factor in whether their ballot counts or not. So we have been purposeful that we would deal with the envelopes and the signatures post primary so that there would be no confusion for the voter or the county boards of elections.
Just as a comment, when you do, you know, if you get the, if you do get the software and the technology, I think there'd probably be some members of this committee that would like to come over to your office just to maybe do some sampling, you know, with our own signatures to see what it looks like, you know, how it works. But
that we can try, but it's going to, you know, we'll have to run the software in the 10 counties. So maybe it needs to be members of the legislature who are in those 10 counties.
And last question. So I think a lot of us have been getting reports from some of our county boards about the change in the deadline to identify the early voting locations. And so I guess my question would be, why is the board doing this over the objections of so many local boards? And what's the necessity when before they had to submit it to you around 90 days before the election? You know, why is it now necessary to do it 180 days before the election?
The decision to call the meeting, therefore to call the plans to be submitted by May 7th by the County Boards of Elections, was the decision of the State Board Chair. He does get to set the agenda. He does get to call the meetings. I can report that while you may be hearing from some individuals, we've had very limited negative response from the counties. Matter of fact, as we went over the processes with the counties during one of our huddles, one even expressed, what else can we do early? We are planners in this profession. And so, you know, we naturally are going to try to take care of everything that we can in advance of an election. And so, you know, right now, many of them are choosing to prepare their supply kits. The rationale from the chair has been that, you know, there is the potential for uncertainty, for there to be changes in our election processes. And right now, one of the things that we do know is that we need early voting plans as we head into the November elections. We have county boards meeting as they conduct a second primary, so there's opportunity for them to go over their early voting plans. The sites, or the number of sites, have been identified in their budget process. So this is not a big lift. We also, the chair factored in that the counties are generally consistent about the number of sites and the location of the sites. And it had also been determined that for more than one cycle now of early voting plans, we are finding that counties are not able to give sufficient notice to some of these facilities and are having to have rec departments choose between voting or pickleball. And that's, you know, we need to provide them opportunity to get those sites secured sooner rather than later. And so, you know, it's a very administrative thing. And, there may be precedents, but it doesn't mean that we can't change things. We have other methods that are in processes that we change the date to accommodate the changes in the election cycle.
Senator Heist, did you want to follow up on that? Okay, Senator Heist, you're right.
Yeah, this has kind of come up, probably not surprising to you. I've got several county commissioners chewing my ears over the runoff election that was not anticipated in their budget for this year. That's coming in, and we've suddenly run up to a lot of challenges and questions I'm answering of, why do we have to keep 17 days of early voting for a election turnout that's probably going to be closer to 2%, considering the general election came close to 24% that's coming in. And I guess I'm just looking at some guidance. Maybe I'm questioning the value of runoffs altogether, given those kind of turnoff numbers, and that's something for me to question. But the process of administering them, should we be more open to allowing counties to reduce the number of sites, the number of early voting days, and others to reflect what is more consistent with turnout expectations?
There's a lot in your question. I'm happy to go through it. One, I'm happy to have conversations with you around the second primary and what some options might be to increase participation. Those are low turnout elections, and there are options. The state even used to employ a method called instant runoff voting. And you may not want to go there, but I'm just saying we can discuss what the options are. But right now, we're following what the law allows. And so, but in terms of early voting plans, you know, there have been changes to early voting. More than not, we have had a 17-day period. What we have seen in North Carolina is that more and more North Carolinians choose to cast their ballot during that early voting period. So, you know, I think we need to be mindful that this is, it's not a partisan issue. More North Carolinians of all party affiliations choose to vote their ballot during the early voting period, typically, especially in general elections, than any of the other two options that they have in terms of voting. If reflecting back on my 18 years in the elections profession, having been a county elections director, and the conversations that I have had on more than one occasion, even recently with county elections directors, is that the change in the law that set very specific hours for all sites is potentially what they have found more cumbersome than the 17-day period. We did used to benefit from the fact that counties could determine which sites would be open, how many hours per day they would be open, so that they could factor in if their county is a heavy commuter county, where they needed to be, it was, you know, more appropriate for them to say be open until 8 o'clock at night, but not maybe open until 10 o'clock. I happen to have been in Transylvania County, where we did have a number of people who commuted. We also had a large retirement community. So we could consider whether, you know, does, you know, a 7 a.m. opening hour make sense for Transylvania? Not necessarily, but it might make sense for, you know, communities with a factory, you know, more industrial county that needs to factor in a schedule there. So that, I think, is the conversation that maybe we need to have, is how do we go back to that flexibility that the counties had in really deciding what works best for their community. I would encourage that before I would suggest that we change the 17-day period that North Carolinians have become so accustomed to.
Is that all, Senator Heiss? Representative Harrison.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'll try and be brief. And I really appreciate your comments, Ms. Brinson-Bell, because I think restoring the flexibility to the counties actually saves a lot of money as well. And I hope we might pursue that action. But I wanted to follow up on a couple of points that were made. Specifically, Senator Newton mentioned the same-day registration changes and the limited number of folks who were impacted by that. But I think you followed up with a point later that the population in the primary is going to be very different from the population in the general election. We'll have significantly more, and maybe significantly more, availing themselves of the same-day voter registration. I don't know how it's worked in the past, but I would expect there would be a large increase of those. And I understand there's litigation, so I think there's still litigation on this particular point, but I didn't want that to go uncommented on. As to the funding, I think it was Senator Perry that mentioned, you know, I just want to throw money at this, but if I heard you, and I want to make sure I got this right, because I just took some notes, you've got additional demands from Senate Bill 747. You've got the shortage of funding for the SEAMS update that's needed. You've got the additional needs given the turnover at the county board levels. You've got this large number of new county board administrators that you'll need regional, I think you said regional coordinators for. And if I remember in the previous conversation, the IT staff, you've got a lot of turnover, able to make more money in the private sector. So you've got a lot of turnover. So did I catch the most critical needs? Are there more?
I think you did capture the most critical needs and what we're focused on in terms of personnel or personnel to support programs that have evolved either through 747 or, you know, the added responsibilities that are in elections now when we talk about cybersecurity and things of that nature. So, I think what we need to be mindful of, and I do appreciate the comments regarding the turnover. I think we do need to be mindful that, I'm in communication with the county boards, and as they look at the pool of applicants and so forth, many people do not have elections experience. And so that means that when we are hiring individuals, they may be very skilled in accounting or have a political science degree and have knowledge of the processes, but to actually administer is a different thing. And so if we don't have a way to grow this profession. And a lot of these counties are rural and they don't have large staffs. And so there is no succession plan because they're one or one and a half person offices. So, there are struggles that, granted, I don't have the historical data to point back to, but to see 5 years of change, to recognize the complexity that continues to evolve in elections. We have the designation of critical infrastructure right now. And that means that, we are it's critical to keep us operational as it is, our power plants or our water system. So we should fund elections with that recognition of significance as well, and have not just more funding. And I'm sure that that sounds like a broken record when I'm asking for more funding, but there is reason to fund us more, and there's reason to be more consistent in the funding. As we've referenced county commissioners and their uncertainty of when there's going to be a second primary or not, things of that nature. I will say my county manager required me to give a estimated second primary budget. It was not part of the budget proposal, but it was there in case they needed to enact it. So I think that's a practice that counties should be carrying out, knowing that there's always a possibility. I segued there, went down a rabbit hole. I'll come back. The county commissioners, there are more demands on them to fund county offices. There's more demands on us. When we're talking about the SEAM system, the counties are the users. We're the maintainers. The counties do not pay for that system, but they are the user of that system. And so there's a state responsibility to fund that and to provide that to them. I don't know if I addressed things you were wanting to.
We did, and I think just follow up, Mr. Chair. I'm cognizant of Senator Newton's comment about election integrity, but we also ought to be able to fund election administration. So I feel like they're equally important. So, thank you. Switching gears really quickly, I heard after the March election a lot about student IDs. About I think specifically Duke has an electronic ID now, and I imagine that the universities are going that way eventually anyway, where we're not going to actually have a. And I'm just wondering where we are in terms of approving that, or can you approve an electronic ID for the universities that are using that, and where we are on sort of the universities that hadn't gotten it in place by the primary, but their deadline's coming up for the general. Thanks.
Yes. I don't recall the exact date, but I believe it's a May date that we've indicated to the universities to public employers or the community college system or charter schools, any school system. Those are acceptable forms of IDs that we have an approval process for. As I recall, all the UNC system schools did submit an ID that has been approved. Many of the private universities have, a majority of the community colleges have. So we don't anticipate there's not a large pool of acceptable forms of ID in the university, community college, public employer system to go through that process with. So, but in terms of the digital IDs, and for everyone's knowledge, there are universities in both the UNC system and private universities that have moved to it being part of their smartphone. And yeah, I think we're also seeing that with driver's licenses in other states. We're not there yet, but and so we do not have any of those approved currently. We are working with them, and they are having to work with many of the smartphone companies, because one of the issues that conflicts with our law and approval process is for an expiration date to be visible on that ID. And so we have not been able to approve those digital IDs because they have thus far have not displayed an expiration date on the digital ID itself. It requires the user to go through other screens, and that's not approvable in our process.
Any other questions from the committee members? I'm seeing none, just one bit of administrative business. All of you should have a per diem form in front of you, so please turn that into the committee clerk. Thank you, Ms. Brinson Bell and Mr. Cox, for being here today and for the presentation,
sir,
to the committee. And this committee is now adjourned.
Letting this go a few more minutes. I always enjoy seeing the interactions at the end of committee meetings. And just a programming note, you may recall from watching my previous videos that the North Carolina General Assembly typically does not archive their meetings in a meaningful way. They live stream them, but there is no way to watch them over again. So that's part of my reporting on this very important issue. Now it shows that the committee has adjourned. In the 27-page presentation from the North Carolina State Board of Elections, you can go through that. It's on the state's website. But some of just highlighting a few points here. I did not show the entire commission meeting. I had another event earlier and had to take my dog to the vet. He's okay, don't worry. But apologies for not capturing the entire meeting. It began at 1 p.m. Now it's 3:30, so it was quite a long meeting. But I will highlight some of the facts. I think the question at the end, to me, is always the most interesting as they move forward and what they decide. So again, to some of the senator's points, especially Senator Hayes, he covers 9 counties, and some of the counties are very have a much lower population than others. So his points about the runoff election were very, very interesting to me. So I'll leave it there. But I do encourage you to go through this presentation in more detail. And there are several components to it that make it challenging, I think, from an election administration position. But the county director turnover is concerning. I disagree with Senator Perry that it's not, because that it is concerning when you have that many people and that institutional knowledge going out the door for various reasons. And bottom line is, we need safe and secure elections, and it needs to be funded accordingly. So I do hope that all parties involved will get to a place where the adequate funding and adequate resources are available. Again, please subscribe to AnnieDance@substack.com. I try to share as much factual nonpartisan, non-biased information as I possibly can. I go into great explanatory detail on my about page about my own political background and my institutional knowledge and where I come from. And just to briefly remind you that I'm a registered and unaffiliated voter, previously a Republican in another state, and previously in another state worked on Republican campaigns. I live in Rutherford County, which is predominantly Republican county. And to be honest, the reason I am not a registered Republican, beside the fact that I'm a serious journalist and I believe it's best to be nonpartisan, is that state law, in order to vote in a primary election, that is really the key reasoning behind being, for me, being an unaffiliated voter, in that you do not have to be a member of a political party to vote in a primary election. So keep that in mind. I'm not saying one way is good or bad or other. I'm saying that's the way it is, and that's what's best for me. I think everyone needs to choose their own path and have as much factual independent information as possible, and I try to bring that out with my journalism. So please follow me on my Substack as well as on social media, X, formerly Twitter, at Annie M. Dance. Thanks for watching. See you next time.